Hello, everybody. I'm very excited to give this third webinar on distillation and fractionation. And the first one was done by my boss and my good friend Kindra Snow McGregor, whose name also was already mentioned by Clay. And I also wish to thank her as well as the famous Mahmoud Mosfegian, who also gave me some good tips. So here we are. This is me, this photo, and I guess a couple of years ago. So I'm a master in chemical engineering, worked extensively in the oil and gas industry, 40 plus years. And since about 10 years, I am teaching for Petroskills, and especially the oil and gas processing and LNG and safety in design. So that's it. This is the third in our series of distillation related and fractionation related presentations. And the first one was done on the October 20th by Kindra, and it concerned the basics of distillation, really the very basics as everybody knows it. And there, based on that information, we are building all our next seminars. And my own webinar, and that was on November 24th, was on the help my distillation products are off spec. And so these two were passed and are really basic to the next ones. But I can understand possibly that many of you might not have attended these two first webinars, and it's not a big problem. We will refer back at times to it, but I also will really recap the conclusions out of it. And if we understand the conclusions, then you can really follow this webinar yourself and much better. And so we want you to all have a level playing field. So those who have attended both the webinars, as well as who are new at this moment, that's why I will recap for a moment the main conclusions from the two webinars, and then we will build up further on it. So the basic principle of a fractionation column is that we make separations, and one of the most important criteria are the boiling points of the different components. And we want our feed, like a crude oil or a raw gas, is not really saleable. So we are going to clean it up, and we are going to separate it, and distillate and bottom products have a specification. So if you are want to adhere to that specification, then we are using the hardware of distillation. And in order to understand the process of distillation, qualitative phase behavior is an important concept as well. And what we derived actually in our earlier webinars is that a distillation or fractionation column is nothing else than a series of flash vessels, where each vessel represents a distillation tray, where the vapor and liquid feeds are intimately mixed to enable mass and heat transfer, after which they are fully separated again. Let's go for a moment to this earlier graph. If we have here a flash vessel, and there are two feeds to the flash vessel, that is vapor from the tray below and liquid from the tray above. They are intimately mixed in this vessel, And when they are intimately mixed, we want then you have got a mass transfer as well as a heat transfer. In general, the highest temperature tray or vessel is in the bottom, and the higher we go, the lower the temperature. And so if we still look at this flash vessel, then if liquid comes from a tray above, then this one is relatively colder. And if vapor is coming from the tray below, this tray is relatively hotter. And so by mixing this cold or relative cold liquid with this hotter vapor, you got heat transfer, and you also got mass transfer, which is that distillation process. And so any tray of any flash vessel is actually representative of each tray. So every tray in a distillation column is represented by a flash vessel. And so that was my this fourth bullet point, which I said each flash vessel represents a distillation tray where the vapor and liquid feed streams are intimately mixed to enable mass as well as heat transfer, after which we must fully and separate them again in a vapor and liquid stream. And that full separation was we make a new vapor and a new liquid. So, one other conclusion is the more stages we have, the purer the product. So, if I add more of these stages on top of it, then I actually make this column longer or taller, and we get a much more pure product. If we add trays over here, you also get pure products in the bottom. And that is very nice and dandy when we are in the design stage. If we say, well, hey, my product is not on spec yet, so well, then we simply add a couple of trays. But at a certain moment, the decision has been made to build it, and then suddenly in your plant, the distillation column is there. It has got a certain height, it got a certain diameter, it has got a number of trays, and suddenly, and if then suddenly my product is still off spec, then we must have other tools to correct my product of my distillate product in order to make it on spec, and we cannot add any more trays. So that is off. And so this adding trays was very nice in the design stage, and in the operational stage we were playing with rebuild duty, reflux ratio, traffic, relative traffic in our columns. And that was, I think, long explained in the previous webinar. And we also said of discussed how we would control the column, and in general column control, fractionated column control should adhere to the KISS principle. Yeah. And so, and KISS is keep it simple, stupid. And that's with any engineering aspect of you. If it is mechanical engineering, process engineering, let's try to keep things simple. And it's already difficult enough. And when it is simple, then it is also easier to control and manage. So as we said, these are the main conclusions of my of the previous webinars, and as Clay said, you can ask if you can revisit this webinar of these webinars in order to refresh your minds, or if you are interested. So for the rest of this session, we are the objectives are we are going to concentrate more on these flash vessels. And these flash vessels were so, what are the trays? And so there are different types of trays. There's a kind of tray nomenclature. And we have got a tray operational diagram. So if you have got a tray of a distillation column which is operating at its design conditions and you want to put twice as much feed through it, well, that is impossible. So there is a kind of maximum capacity of my distillation column, and of course the maximum capacity of any column is the weakest link is the tray which is having is reaching its maximum capacity itself. So we will talk about the tray operational constraint diagram, which maximum capacities do we meet where, and also at the lower end. Then we talk about, concentrate more on the four types of flooding phenomena. So if you are coming in the control room and operators say, hey, my column is flooding, then it is not always the same. It is a flooding can be on caused by four different aspects, and we will go over it. So my session is really qualitative. And that means that I give you tools and thinking models in order to apply as engineer or as operational expert in the control, to apply it on distillation. And so every time a problem of problem might be different, but you have now got, and that's what I also tried in my previous seminar, is some tools in order to apply. At the low end, we might have weeping and sealing phenomena, and we will discuss that, so don't worry if this does not make sense now. Tray up and down scaling effects. So for instance, if I have a tray and I've got a conventional tray, and I I'm going to increase the diameter with a factor 2. Well, yeah, what happens then with my liquid and my vapor capacities, and how do they change? And very important for our flooding understanding, flooding phenomena are tray pressure drops. So we will recognize different tray areas. We will can name the 10 most important criteria for a distillation tray and understand the different contributions to a tray pressure drops. Yeah, so this is actually are the streams happening in a distillation column. So we remember we have that distillation column, and in principle, yeah, you can decide upon, this is the feed, and you can decide upon the feed preheat. And so partly that feed preheat is making vapor, and the vapor goes up in the column and is joined by the vapor which has been reboiled, of as a resultant of the reboiler. And here you've got a condenser, and condenser condenses, of course. Partly you've got your distillate yield, and partly it is your reflux down the column. And the more traffic, relative traffic you have of vapor going up and liquid going down, the better the separation in general. Yeah, and here you've got your reboiler, and you have got your bottom product. And this means actually so that everywhere in this column we have got our trays, and we are going, and these trays are our subject of, and to the flooding of them possibly, and the operation of this webinar. So we will explain tray layout. This is a distillation tray. If you so remember, we have that column of that flash vessel or any tray, and we knew that a colder liquid comes from above, hot vapor, relatively hot vapor, is coming from below. You are intimately mixing it, and then you separate it, and you have got your new vapor and your new liquid. And then, so this flash vessel is representative of this distillation tray. And so in this distillation tray, cold liquid from the tray above is coming to this tray, and it is flowing over the tray and overflowing in a downcomer. And so, as we said, it should intimately mix with a vapor, and the vapor comes from below and goes through bubbling devices. And these bubbling devices see to it that while the liquid is flowing over my tray, it is intimately mixed with all this vapor. And so this here, the intimate mixing, temperature exchange and heat exchange and mass transfer take place. So this is a liquid, and it has been fractionated, it has had a new equilibrium, and this liquid is overflowing into this downcomer box. And this downcomer box, and because we had a very intimate contact here, you have got a two-phase liquid, actually, of two-phase. You've got a frothy liquid going into the downcomer. And so the downcomer must see to it that you have got time enough and possibility enough in order to disengage your vapor bubbles out of your liquid. And so the liquid should not have a too high velocity downwards, because otherwise it will entrain all these vapor bubbles, and you would have actually recycled. The vapor was coming here, it was intimately mixed, and you would recycle your vapor, and that is absolutely not the objective. So over here is the downcomer, where my liquid is disengaging, of is getting rid of its vapor bubbles, and here the process on the next tray is happening again. So we have intimate mixing of hot vapor coming from below. Well, this tray has a slightly higher temperature than this tray, and this tray has a slightly higher temperature than this tray. So this tray, the liquid from this tray, is colder. Yeah, so we've got hot vapor from the tray below. We mix with cold liquid from the tray above. And we enable intimate mixing and mass transfer and heat transfer. And then we must have excellent separation again. We must get rid of all my vapor bubbles out of my liquid. And here we have got liquid droplets possibly entrained with my vapor, and that these liquid droplets must fall down again. And so the vapor which reaches the next tray should be clear of droplets of liquid. Yeah, and so in the downcomer, we must separate the vapor bubbles of the liquid, and so that happens in the downcomer. And in the tray, in this tray spacing, is we must enable the liquid droplets which were entrained to fall back again, and the same happens, of course, over here. Yeah, so that is a tray. And so a tray has got a maximum capacity. And so, yeah, if you have got too much liquid at a certain moment, then this downcomer cannot accommodate that liquid anymore. And you are forced to have a too high flow, and so on. So we will talk about it. A tray is designed for a certain condition. Yeah? So, how does it then possibly look in practice? Well, this is a very small distillation column. Here, the liquid is coming, the liquid is coming from the tray above, is overflowing, and it is coming in this area. We call this the bubbling area. Here, this is actually for valve trays, and the valves are not inserted yet, and the valves are having about, of these holes have about a diameter of 1 inch. And so we are overflowing this liquid of this tray with liquid, and you've got an overflow weir here. And the higher this overflow weir, which goes, when the liquid overflows this this weir, it comes into this downcomer and the process starts again. But so the higher this overflow weir, the higher your liquid level on this tray, and perhaps thanks to that you will have a better intimate contact between the vapor, which the vapors which are coming through the holes and the valves and the this liquid. Yeah, and so there are many designs here of how these conventional tray valves might look like. This is an example of Glitch, and a closer look at it is actually that you have got a kind of cap. And so if we have got our hole in our tray, and I said this is about 1 inch wide, and so we have got our hole in our tray, and in this case you have got these legs, and but there is a kind of valve, and the higher my vapor flow, this valve will lift higher. And so this valve can, dependent on the vapor flow being presented to this hole, can lift up and make a bigger area for the vapor to pass through. And if the vapor flow is low, then this cap of this valve will close, and that prevents possibly liquid being bypassing from of through the hole which is designated for my vapor. Here's a sieve tray, and a sieve tray is nothing else than all small holes, and they are about have a diameter of about a half an inch, and so there's no valve mechanism. But don't worry, a very good designed sieve tray even can have a turn down ratio to 30% of throughput. So you can go back to 1/3 of your feed of your design conditions, and that is very good. And again, so here, keep things simple, and the KISS principle. If why going for extensive or more difficult type of trays if you design it well, have it as simple as possible. Yeah. And the original type of bubbling device was a bubble cap tray, and a bubble cap tray looks as follows. And a bubble cap tray has got an infinite turn down ratio. Your vapor passes through, and your liquid has is flowing in this direction. And if the vapor flow is low, then this design sees to it that you don't bypass your liquid this way around. That is so not happening. So we've got different bubbling devices. You can have sieve trays, you can have valve trays, you can have bubble cap trays, and they are all different types of designs. Yeah, so on a tray there is an eternal fight between, hey, we have got the downcomer area for the tray of the liquid coming from the tray above. This is the downcomer area for the liquid which is going to the tray below, and we have got this total bubble area, and this bubble area is actually where my fractionation takes place, the intimate contact between my vapor and liquid, enabling mass transfer and heat transfer. And this is more the separation of my liquid, of my vapor, getting my vapor out of my liquid. So let's go over some nomenclature. And we have got a column diameter, and the inside of that column diameter is the total internal cross-sectional area. And that consists of my downcomers, it consists of the yellow part, and it consists of the holes where my vapor goes through. So blue is the downcomer area, and that is normally expressed as percentage of the internal cross-sectional area. The bubbling area, which is really where the fractionation takes place, is the yellow and my red. And red is net free area, again expressed as percentage of the internal cross-sectional area. And so that is the number of holes we have in my tray. Yeah, so yeah, if this is a tray with the same diameters, then actually the same column diameter, here we have got more fractionation possible, and here you got less fractionation, but the liquid load is so very high, possibly in this one. But we will see that liquid load, the very first step of the liquid load is actually is the weir length, and the weir length is the liquid must overflow over this weir in order to go into the downcomer. Yeah, so vapor handling capacity is proportional to the net free area, and that is in square meters. Liquid handling capacity is actually proportional to my first of all to my overflow weir. And so suppose we increase a column diameter with a factor 2 and commensurately increase this one and that one, then actually by having increased my column diameter, I also increased my weir length with a factor 2. And that means that my liquid capacity, handling capacity, has increased with a factor 2. But my vapor handling capacity, this one goes by the square. And so the tray design, and for a certain feed, is very much, at least for conventional trays, is very much dependent on the actual situation, the actual throughput. And if you would have a twice as big throughput, then you might get into problems that if you have increased your column diameter with a factor 2, your liquid handling capacity has gone up with a factor 2, and my vapor handling capacity, which is proportional to that area, has gone up with a factor 4. So that's one of the things to be aware of. And some companies like Shell and so on have solved that by having multiple downcomers hanging in your from a tray. Yeah, so if that is not the if it is not proportional, the at least the liquid and vapor handling capacity, then very often, and you need a higher liquid of my vapor handling capacity has gone up with a factor 4, and my liquid with a factor 2, then you need more liquid handling capacity. And so possibly you must go over to split trays. So this was a normal of the normal conventional tray. And here, this one has got more liquid capacity, and you can see a split tray that the liquid is coming down in from two downcomers. Then it is going to this one, and it is a split again. And so a two-pass tray has got much more weir lengths, and so a higher, in that way you increase the liquid capacity with an in an easy way by splitting the flows. Yeah. Yeah. So that is this one. So we discuss these in their images. Okay. So where are we? We are. This is so my dunk my tray. And this is my overflow in my downcomer box. And here you've got frothy liquid, and you want to disengage the vapor bubbles out, you get clear liquid, and you are going to have a clear liquid to the tray below. So if we have a look at pressure drops, then a vapor is going from a high pressure drop to a low pressure drop. Otherwise it will not flow. So there is a high pressure drop and there a low pressure drop. And so one way or other, my downcomer must be able to handle all the pressure drops. And so let's have a look at indicative contributions and what is the total pressure drop over a tray. So if there is no liquid available or present, and you still have got your vapor going through your all these holes, then these holes are a kind of resistance, and we call that the dry tray pressure drop. And so we are expressing my pressure drop in milliliters tray liquid, and so this downcomer must have all these pressure drops and have enough height in order to overcome my all these pressure drops. So you've got a dry tray pressure drop, and that is the holes in my and my bubbling devices. You got a wet tray pressure drop, or in other words, there is a clear lick of a liquid on that tray, and that liquid is presenting also a pressure drop. You have got the exit of my downcomer box. So that represents a pressure drop. You have got a submergence downcomer on this tray, and that is representing a pressure drop. So it is in total about 240 milliliters tray liquid. But this is all clear liquid. And in here, we don't have clear liquid, we have frothy liquid. So to have 240 milliliters of clear liquid, you must have a much higher height in order to accommodate for the frothiness. Yeah? And so that is, these are indicative figures for a pressure drop. And possibly my liquid might be foaming, and foaming is always in the process energy industry a very difficult aspect. It can be nuclei of rust or fouling, and this surface tensions which play a role, but so some liquids are more have a higher tendency to foam than others, but you are making the downcomer slightly higher in order to accommodate possibly for the nature of foaming. Yeah, so we do that. So what are the tray operating limits? Here we have got liquid load. And the higher the liquid load, we go to the right. Here we've got vapor load, and the higher vapor load, we go in this. And here we have got actually a safe operating area of my tray. And so there are some limitations, and we will discuss what are these limitations that because if we pass, well, try to pass these limitations and want to operate over here, our column definitely is flooding. And there are also on the low operational side some trade limitations. So let's have a look. Here we have got entrainment, and entrainment. Here we've got priming. Here we've got downcomer backup, and here we've got downcomer choking. And in general, these four we call flooding. So if somebody in the control room says my column is flooding, then it can be thanks to the fact that it is entrainment takes place, priming takes place, downcomer is not good. So it is the webinar is giving you really tools to understand a little bit better in a qualitative way what can possibly really happen. On the low operational side, we have got weeping and we have got ceiling. And so what is entrainment? Entrainment we knew is that on a distillation tray, and we've got our liquid and it's going into the next downcomer box, that we have got a very frothy phenomenon over here, and possibly some liquid will droplets are being taken with my vapor. And if I go to a higher vapor flow, if I go to a higher vapor rate, the law of Stokes is that you will have you will not disengage, of you not, do not allow anymore your liquid droplets to fall back, and they are entrained. So entrainment is there's not enough liquid to form a stable frostbed, and the liquid breaks up into droplets, and these droplets are carried by my vapor to the tray above. Priming is a bed expansion. And priming, it looks a little bit like foaming, but it is not foaming. It is really the expansion of my bed. So I've got my tray here, I've got my tray there, and I've got a very frothy liquid. And the more frothiness I have, and the higher capacities, at a certain moment, this frothiness reaches my tray above. And so that is priming. The froth on a tray becomes more aerated, bed expansion takes place, and the froth bed reaches the tray above. Downcomer backup is when the downcomers are not large enough to carry the liquid away from the tray. We already saw that the downcomer pressure drop is too great. You must enable their frothy liquid to disengage of the vapor, and the downcomer simply is too small. And downcomer choking is when the velocity of liquid in the top of the downcomer is so high that vapor is drawn into the liquid and you do not disengage anymore. Okay, so these are the maximum capacity flooding phenomena. So there are also the symptoms of flood which we then meet is some trays might start flooding, and so that means that the liquid is not really finding its way down again, it is being pushed up and so on, and so you get an accumulation of vapor and liquid, while it should be a dynamic process which has what goes in must come out, but now liquid is building up and you get a high pressure drop. So you, if you measure a higher pressure drop, you know what can happen with this flooding. Low temperature. So we know that in general this temperature is lower than that temperature, and that there's a kind of temperature profile of all over across all the trays. But if the liquid from one tray reaches the other one, you get temperature equalization, and so the temperature drops is not anymore ideal. At a certain moment, liquid is puking into my overhead accumulator, and so that is, and you get less loss of level in the bottom, and because there's no fractionation anymore, your distillate product is not anymore on spec, and your bottom product neither. So you got really instabilities. And we will see what should we do actually to cure it. A good engineer, of course, has when the column was ever erected, and you've got test runs, always when an advice is when you have got a well working plant, do take test runs such that you have got information. So because when once you have got problems, then at least you have got your design data, you have got your operational data of your test run, and so you've got some tools to know where I'm going back to. And so if my column is flooding, then it can be either entrainment, priming, downcomer backup, and downcomer choking, and you can have tools that is outside the scope of this webinar in order to really calculate which phenomena is at this moment prevailing and giving me my flooding mechanism. So we have got flooding, the operator sees an increase of pressure across the column, a loss in bottom product flow, a sharp drop in column efficiency, and your overhead accumulator might get your there was puking, and there's a liquid level coming in higher. So the distillation of many companies which are either operators or designers or delivering the hardware are assembled in the Fractionation Research Institute. And our PetroSkills is also a member of that institute, and they have got also an excellent movie on what is happening inside a distillation column. And inside a distillation column, things are going much wilder than you might think. We think that we have got a very nicely flowing liquid, and it is overflowing over there. But in principle, it is a very wild phenomena on your trays. And so here we have got the spray regime, and you can see really that there is a little liquid, and this liquid has been broken into all kind of small droplets, and these small droplets are entrained. And so this is the spray regime and bubble and froth regimes you can recognize. But have a look, if possible, if your company has got a membership at this excellent movie by FRI, Fractionation Research Institute. So we have now discussed actually the high capacity side, and I would like to go also over to the low capacity side. So that is sealing and weeping. And so weeping is the passing of liquid through the holes of the bubble area. So we had our tray and all the holes where the vapor was supposed to go. But if now the liquid says, hey, of the vapor is not really covering these holes well enough, then possibly the liquid says, well, hey, I am going via the holes of the vapor. And so weeping is the passing of liquid through the holes in the bubbling area. And these holes were designed to pass through the vapor from the tray below and not the liquid. The weeping liquid takes a shortcut through the tray, reducing the contact between vapor and liquid on the frost bed. The result is a drop in efficiency, so we normally can tolerate nearly 30% of the liquid to weep, because the liquid must anyway go from a higher tray to a lower tray. And sealing is when the liquid load in the downcomer falls, and there's a point where the vapor can enter the downcomer and is looking for the route of least resistance and is going via, so the vapor is going via the downcomer, which is designated actually for my liquid. Yeah, and so here is are some by the FRI. You can see here you are weeping. Here it starts weeping, and you can see liquid weeping down in my column. And so if my column is flooding, then during operation, the big step you normally have to take is reduce throughput. And so you reduce your throughput and that then gradually increase your throughput again. But it is nice to know in a qualitative way what possibly is the cause. Is it entrainment, is it priming, is it downcomer, backup, and so on. And during design, we of course, the eternal fight between bubbling area, weir length, net free area, is that we must try to design the most optimal tray. Yeah, and so important parameters which affect tray efficiency is the liquid height on the tray. The higher my liquid, the more liquid bulk there is in order to have your intimate mixing. And the liquid flow path, and the liquid flow path is nothing else than we had our downcomer. And so what is the length of my flow path? And if I now have a split trace also, then so this is a downcomer, this is the downcomer, this is the downcomer, you might reduce your flow path. The higher my flow path, of course, the more time you give the liquid to meet vapor and intimately mix. Yeah, so the we have tray operating limits. And so the tray operating limits, we already talked about entrainment, priming, downcomer, and downcomer backup. And so in principle, you can make for a given column diameter, you can have an optimum design, and if the liquid load is fairly low, and that is with this curve, then this is the optimum. But you can also have the same cross-sectional area for another type of operation where you've got a higher liquid load. You have gone to a higher liquid load, and even more, so this is the increased bubbling area, and here is even one which is even more increased. So in principle, during design, we are looking the objective is that we make a column as cheap as possible. The shell of a column is about 80% of the total cost. The trays are perhaps 10 to 20% of the total costs. And and it can be a fairly expensive piece of equipment. So you really want to have a minimum diameter. But with this minimum diameter, you can have different optimal designs depending on your different vapor and liquid loads. But so we have made now a locus of a combination of maximum capacity curves, and that is that black line. And here you've got a liquid load, and here you've got a vapor load, and we do make that this liquid load and vapor load are density corrected in order to accommodate these graphs, or to let these graphs be valid for all operating regimes of all pressures and temperatures. And so at a higher pressure, we've got higher vapor densities. At lower pressures, we've got lower vapor densities. And now the vapor load, which is here in meters per second, is density corrected according to the Saunders-Brown equation. But that is something which is being discussed in the G4 as well as in the oil processing course, PF4. But at this moment, if you don't understand it, simply believe me that there is a kind of density correction of this one in of the vapor, as well as a density correction of the liquid, in order to make this curve true for all pressures and temperature combinations. So then we are going to design, and here is the for instance the slope, our current feed which we want to split has got a certain vapor ratio and a liquid ratio. And so this is the maximum capacity at a given column diameter. And it is easier, they found it actually easier that when you are, so this is the, was the Saunders-Brown equation and which we are using. Yeah, and the density corrected vapor and liquid loads, that we say, well, instead of liquid load, we have a density corrected V over L, so that is the vapor of the liquid flow over the vapor flow. And so if I know I've got a certain feed to my column, and I've got a certain tray, and I've got my vapor to the tray and my liquid to this tray, then there is a ratio. And so there is a volumetric flow of liquid, and you've got a volumetric flow of vapor. If you divide these by the cross-sectional area, you actually got meters per second, and meters per second for liquid and vapor. So it is liquid and vapor. And so if you use that ratio, I know that ratio, then you can know where you are on this horizontal scale. For a certain bubbling device, you can read off my vapor load. And so that is a density corrected superficial gas velocity. And so if I know my superficial gas velocity, if I know my volumetric flow rate of my vapor, if I know my, and I just read that off, my superficial gas velocity, if I divide them over each other, I get actually cross-sectional area. And so if I know the cross-sectional area in square meters, I can calculate the diameter of the column. So actually this graph, which is applicable for a certain bubbling device, and we know our VL over VG, you can simply read off your superficial gas velocity, and if you know your superficial gas velocity, you know also your total volumetric flow rate, the diameter of your column, the minimum diameter is resultant. And so vertically we have the density corrected vapor superficial velocity. Superficial velocity is assuming my vapor is alone in the column. And so there is no liquid and there's no hardware, it's simply my vapor in my column. Superficial liquid velocity is assuming my liquid is alone in the column. So a velocity is nothing else than the volumetric flow rate divided by the cross-sectional area. Yeah, so horizontal is density corrected L over G, so that's L over gas. And indicating whether the system is vapor or liquid dominated. This here we've got, of course, liquid dominated. Here we have got vapor dominated area. And you can, dependent on your building device, you can so design your column and your minimum column diameter. Yeah, so that is this. The curve is independent of throughput, only depends on liquid and vapor ratio and the type of bubbling device. And further, the curve is independent of densities because we have density corrected. Yeah, so we all had this one already, and we talked about the operations of the tray. And so let's go over criteria of a distillation tray. The criteria for a distillation tray is that you must provide for intimate vapor and liquid mixing. And so dependent on your circumstances, the vapor-liquid ratio can be different. You must also, when you have mixed it, the same tray must provide for excellent separation. It should be able to accommodate the required capacity. It should have a high efficiency and flexibility, turn down characteristics. It should have as low as possible pressure drop if possible. Some of our operations are, of course, fouling, and you want fouling resistance. You don't want rust or fouling to jeopardize the operation of my valves, for instance, because then it goes wrong, of course. Again, the KISS principle, the simplicity of design, the easy to erect and maintain, because otherwise my shutdowns last very, very long. And our whole process industry and any industry is revolving about minimum costs. Yeah. So easy, erect and maintain. Here you can see a panel for the manway, for instance, and you see some clips or so. And so you want to be able to easy erect and maintain. So key messages which we had during this this presentation. So we know and understand the four flooding mechanisms, know the symptoms of flooding, which were high pressure drop, low temperature range of change in temperature, poor heat and mass transfer. We have got the distillation products going off spec for the bottom product and so on. But what the tools we have to remove flooding constraints, especially in the design, of course, no important parameters which affect the tray efficiency. But review your process conditions before diving in and replacing trays. As I said, try to have test runs already in the time that your operations were excellent and nobody was looking. Nobody is normally looking at well operating pieces of the plant. But as soon as the plant then gives problems, then suddenly everybody is in panic and we don't have any tools and mechanisms and data anymore to go back to. And so we first dive into the analysis of the problem rather than immediately replacing trays. And vendors will always try to sell you the hardware. These were the objectives which we set ourselves earlier. And so the different types of trays, and especially so just the conventional trays with the with dual flow mechanisms or a single flow, what kind of bubbling of valves we can have, and or sieve trays and bubble caps. The different tray areas, we named the 10 most important criteria for a distillation tray and understand the different contributions to tray pressure drops. So there are possibilities for a next seminar if you like it. And so this was the third seminar we had, how does floating pressure control work? We can talk about the flash formula, which knowledge enables us to understand why on a platform in the Gulf of Mexico or so, it is more advantageous to have 4 separator stages than 1, and what are the advantages and why does it pay out? If there's a field stabilizer column of spec with respect to H2S, why does my flash formula enable me to understand, to know what to do? Why my field stabilizer column in the exploration and production in the upstream is often only a stripping column rather than equipped with a full rectifying section. So the rectifying section is, so you've got a column, and this is the stripper, and this is the rectifying section. And very often in the upstream, you bring your feet to the top, and you have got only a stripper section. And why is that so? So this use of the flash formula, we will explain this, and then you know it for the rest of your life. My column is flooding. We just did a fractionator column constraint diagram. And possibly the messages out of the very good tool of the McCabe Thiele diagram. And if you are from the refineries, so yeah, why do we have pump arounds and what are the functions of a pump around and how do we utilize it the best? Yeah, so this is actually. I would like to go to a speed quiz, but that is possibly the easiest to do that is to go for a Kahoot. And so let us have a look at whether my... let's open Kahoot. My apologies that I did not do that earlier. Login, and we will test your hey teacher personal. Hey, I'm doing something wrong. Hang on. Login. Yeah, Google. So Kahoot is a game actually which helps us to understand, to reinforce the learning. And so how we are going to do that is the following, is that what you are going to do is if you've got a mobile phone, then please go to enter in your browser www.kahoot.it. Yeah? So www.kahoot.it, and then there is they ask for a game pin. And the game pin is here given as 1467956. So we have got Mr. or Mrs. Flooding, Brutus, AIV, Hit. And so this is a game, and it will ask you questions. And these questions are then, you must score. And see who, at the end of 10 questions, we will see who is the winner. Yeah, so www.kahoot.it with this game pin. People are still coming in, so happy they found So we've got flooding and downcomer. These are and Mr. and Mrs. Column, priming even. Weeping. Okay, I don't see anybody coming in anymore. Let's start. The four flooding, column flooding mechanisms are the red, yellow, blue, or green. 7 seconds. Eleven got it right. Very good. So the four column flooding mechanisms are entrainment priming, downcomer choking, and downcomer backup. Trace spacing is not a flooding mechanism. Weir length is not a flooding mechanism. And possibly water on the tray can cause havoc. So those who were green might give themselves also a small pat on the shoulder. But the blue one was really what we were going for. And priming is one of the flooding mechanisms and is even leading the pack. Okay. True or false? The net free area of a tray is the area where intimate vapor-liquid contact takes place. The net free area is take of the net free area of a tray is the area where intimate vapor liquid contact takes place. That's wrong. What I have got here, it is false. And why is it false? Because the net free area is that percentage of whole area. The bubbling area, the blue one, the bubbling area is where the intimate vapor and liquid contact takes place. That's the bubbling area. So the definition above was the one of bubbling area. The net free area is the percentage of that whole area. Yeah? Well done. So priming is leading even further. Next one. True or false, the top of the downcomer is wider than the bottom in order to facilitate easier vapor disengagement. It's either wider or the same, but never smaller on the top. And why? True, indeed. We know that a frothy liquid is coming into the downcomer, so in order to have that bigger bulk of frothy liquid and enabling the vapor disengagement, we need a vertical downflow of my liquid to be lower, and so possibly my top of the downcomer is wider than my bottom. And another advantage of this actually is that we are, when the bottom of the downcomer is smaller, we are making the bubbling area bigger. And in the bubbling area, the fractionation takes place. So that is one other thing. Priming. Very good. True or false? Increasing weir height results in a smaller downcomer. Height. Right. So we talk about rear height, not rear length. False, indeed, very good. Increasing rear height results in an, what is that? Increasing rear height causes that my liquid on my tray is getting more, higher liquid. So the pressure drop for my vapor to pass through the liquid is bigger, and that pressure drop must be taken care of in my downcomer. So my downcomer height will increase rather than decrease. Well done. Throughout the tower, all trays are designed similarly, and that is of course cheaper. So if you have got 8 different designs for your whole tray, it So have a look at this, whether throughout the tray, as much as possible, try to have similar trays, yes or no. So it is throughout the tray, all trays are designed similar, the possibly with alternate, the bottom trays, like the stripper column, are of course different than the top trays. But we want to make it as far as possible similar, but you can never have a whole column with the same trays. You must adapt to different operational different operation in the in some parts of the column. A stripper is really operating differently than an rectifying section. Priming is doing an excellent job. It's already 1500 points higher than the next one, but best is also very good. 6 of them. Using the output of a simulator, we need to use vapor to the tray and liquid from the tray. Here your clear sinking must be used. So we are designing a tray, and for the design of the tray, should we have the tray to the tray and through the holes, or of the vapor through the tray? So it is true, we need to use vapor to the tray, because that vapor goes through my bubbling devices, like my sieve, and liquid from my tray, because that is the one which is overflowing in my downcomer boxes and which is deciding my pressure drops. Yeah. Next one, 7. So 4 more. 5 is the dimensionless parameter indicating whether a tray is vapor or liquid dominated, and that is the L over G on the horizontal scale in the design of my column, of in the design in that general graph which we saw. It's true. Well done. Next. The dimension of the C-factor lambda parameter is dimensionless, so that is the superficial gas velocity. Is the superficial gas velocity, is that dimensionless or not? It's false, indeed. It is not dimensionless. It is the superficial gas velocity, and the velocity is meters per second or miles per hour or whatever. It is a dead dimension. Well done, priming. Lambda parameter is the same as the K value in the Saunders-Brown equation. Well, that is not fair of me to ask. But that is so the in the G4 course, the superficial gas velocity. So life is not fair, unfortunately, and so And I must apologize for my not, but it is true. Well done. So it is the k value in the Saunders-Brown equations, the lambda parameter, and it's simply the again the superficial gas velocity. JM is back with an answer streak of 3. Well done, JM. We are proud of you. And make it a streak of 4. The bigger my tray spacing, the higher tray capacity I have. True. Why is it true? It's that trace spacing is really enabling. The higher my trace spacing, the better the liquid entrained liquid droplets can fall back. And so, if I've got a very small trace spacing, then end priming will happen earlier. My bed expansion will reach my my upper tray earlier. My liquid droplets do not have enough time to fall back, and so on. So it is really true. And let's go then to the podium. I think I know who is there. Brutus, well done on as number 3. SSR, well done. And priming, 10 out of 10. I suggest that priming next time will give this webinar and give me an easy time. Thank you very much. Kindra, are you going to take over from me?
All right, Gerard, thank you for the excellent presentation. We have a number of questions. So, Clay, do we have time to spend some time asking Gerard some questions?
Yeah, let's go ahead and cover a few with the few minutes we've got remaining.
Okay, so the first question that I have is from Jason Hishka, and his question is, what is inlet inactivity, and why does it cause cross-flow channeling, and how is it related to the other phenomenon discussed today?
Can you repeat the first part, please?
Yes, what is inlet inactivity?
And inactivity.
Yes. So go ahead, please.
No, I have no idea what inactivity is, of inlet inactivity.
So, you know, I didn't either. And what I'm thinking it is, Gerard, is I suspect that is poor inlet gas distribution. And so can you speak a little bit, if I have, for example, a fractionation column where I don't have a vein inlet distributor, or let's say, you know, for some reason I have a plug vein or damaged vein, I have poor inlet gas distribution. How can that cause cross flow channeling on my tray, and what will that do to my separation efficiency?
Okay. So, indeed, with the flow mechanisms, is the nice thing. Hang on. Let me go for the pencil again. Hang on. The nice thing of a distillation column is that if something has gone wrong with one tray, you always got the next chance. Hey, there is my this tray will work, and this one was not working. And so for whatever reason this tray was not working, the next trays will work again. And so that is opposite to what is happening with in a packed column. In a packed column, if you've got a packed bed and you already start with a mal distribution, and so if you have got a mal distribution and some more liquid at this side than at that side, then suddenly the vapor says, well, I'm going via the route of the least resistance and is bypassing all this beautiful liquid, and there's no fractionation taking place because it happens of the vapor will simply bypass the liquid. And so this is opposite to what if you've got trays. Every time you've got a mal distribution on a tray, the next tray will cure it again. So coming back to your question is from the inlet over a tray. You can have an inlet here. The liquid came from the tray above. Here it goes to the tray below. And if you have got inlet mal distribution, and so you've got a mal distribution over this tray, it is really not dramatic. We will have the next tray has got new chances. And normally, you anyway are adding three more trays, for instance, than that you would have with your. As minimum for your design. And so in principle, I think, was it Jason, that it should not be a big problem. Did you see my drawing, by the way? Was it still on the web share?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, okay, excellent, yeah.
Okay, good, excellent, thank you.
Well, is that good, or do you think that was the question?
So the question wasn't in regards necessarily to liquid cross-flow channeling, it was in regards to gas.
Okay.
But I think your explanation, because it would apply to either case, yes?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
All right, so next question. How can I tell if my trays are fouling? How would I know if my trays were starting to foul?
Ah, that's an excellent question. With fouling of trays, you are losing efficiency. And so, fouling mechanisms can be very diverse, of course, dependent totally on what you are having. If you have got a feed and the feed is already fouling, then most likely your liquid is going down, is entraining the fouled material. The fouled material is depositing on the trays and possibly jeopardizing the operation of my valves and so on. So if you in course of time really see that and the pressure drop, for instance, in the that bottom of the column is going up, and my efficiency is going down, and I need more reboil duty in order to strip better, then that can be really an indication that there is fouling taking place. You can also have fouling in top of columns in refineries, for instance, by ammonium chloride deposition and so on. So it's totally dependent on your operation, but definitely a fault part of a column will have higher pressure drops, and if you are able to measure at different places the pressure drop, that would be ideal. Your efficiency, so that is also the product quality, your distillate product quality and your bottom product quality go down, and you need to cure that by more reflux and more traffic in the column, and so higher reboil duties. These are all signs that in the course of time, if you really need to jack that up more, that fouling might have taken place.
Excellent, thank you. Next question, can you comment on pressure pulses causing trays to fail and fall into the bottom of the tower?
Yeah, the pressure causes, you mean?
Pressure pulses, so you know, all of a sudden you have a lot more gas and you lift a tray.
The pressure pulses is, As we all and as operators and as designers know, the more stable my operation, the better it is. Well, so what can cause pressure pulses? For instance, if you are starting up in a refinery, the crude distiller. The crude distiller is working at about, I think, 460 Fahrenheit, but it's 350 degrees C, and that is well over the boiling temperature of my water. And so if I have had, I'm starting up after my shutdown, and if there is, for the cleaning, still pockets of water present, then 1 liter of water or 1 gallon of water will expand to 1700 gallons of vapor. And so that explosion goes through your column and your trays will fall all down and be damaged and or fall down to the bottom of your column. And so this is one of the reasons, but also other pressure pulses. You can exactly, that's outside the scope of this webinar, but you can exactly calculate what kind of pressure pulse you need in order to collapse a tray. When I once started up Oman LNG, we used the columns as buffer vessels for blowing clean our pipework. And so these pressure vessels and distillation columns, which had the trays inside already, then suddenly were being depressurized and that depressurization flow was used to blow the pipes downstream clean. But it was no problem because we calculated exactly what was the permitted pressure pulse in order to do so. So from a mechanical point of view, you can calculate exactly for any tray the pressure pulse at which it will ultimately collapse.
Excellent. One final question. Why is my dry tray pressure drop larger than the wet tray delta P?
Very good question. So, if we have got a hole, and if this is, for instance, a sieve tray, we know that vapor is going through my holes and my liquid must go over it. And we know from basic fluid dynamic calculations that if my flow is twice as high, then my pressure drop is 4 times as high. So the pressure drop goes with the with the square of a flow increase. And with these ones, with these trays, we have got we must guard, especially with sieve trays, that we prevent liquid bypassing. So we, in general, are designing in such a way that we have got quite of a reasonably high flow in my through my holes, and a reasonably high flow will also imply a higher pressure drop. And so, without the liquid being present and only my my hardware, these resistances are representative of a certain pressure drop. But it is all very dependent. So this is one of the aspects that contribute to that. I hope that helps. Kinder still there?
I sure am. I just couldn't get to my button on time.
Sorry.
Okay. All right. So I think that takes care of most of our questions, and we're 30 minutes over. There was a number of questions that were addressed in the chat, and Gerard will have a chance to take a look at my responses and to chime in as well. One final thing. I do want to point out that we have a suggestion in terms of including divided distillation design in the next lecture. Gerard, are you familiar with divided distillation design?
That is a dividing wall, I think.
Ah, okay, okay.
I never worked with it myself. I have read articles on it. It's a very interesting concept, but it is way out of any webinar. I think it's the dividing wall. There's a kind of vertical wall in my column, and that means also at the other side of my feed inlet, and it can do some nice things distillation-wise.
I have seen photos of those columns. I'm not familiar with those either.
Okay, yeah.
All right, good stuff. So I guess with that said, Clay, would you like to close the session out?
Yes, thank you, Kendra, for manning the Q&A. We'll make sure that all those get captured so people can see the ones that were addressed during the session. And Gerard, thank you very much for an excellent presentation.
My pleasure. Thanks a lot.
And thanks to all of you for joining us. We will send out the recording, as I mentioned, and hope to see you in future Tech Tuesday webinars. So everybody stay safe and take care.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. And thank you all for coming and joining.
Thank you, Gerard.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.